Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Queen Mother, the untold story of Elizabeth Bowes Lyon, who became Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, by Lady Colin Campbell, narrated by Jennifer M. Dixon. Introduction. At 3:15 p.m. on Holy Saturday, the 30th of March, 2002, Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, slipped peacefully away at the grand old age of 101. With her, at Royal Lodge in Windsor Great Park, were her daughter, Queen Elizabeth II, her grandson, David Viscount Linley, her granddaughter, Lady Sarah Chateau, her niece Margaret, the Honourable Mrs. Rhodes, and the chaplain of St. George's Chapel, Canon John Ovenden, who had held her hand as she lapsed into unconsciousness 10 minutes before her death, praying aloud and uttering the Highland lament. I am going now into the sleep, be it that I in health shall awake. If death be to me a deathly sleep, be it that in thine own arms keep. O God of grace, to new life I wake, O be it in thy dear arms keep. O God of grace, that I shall awake. As so often had occurred during her life, the occasion was almost perfectly staged. Her death was peaceful and painless. It had been expected, not least by the old lady herself, who had spent the previous week ringing up old and trusted friends and retainers, saying goodbye and distributing tokens of her regard. In death, as in life, however, perfection is elusive, and so it proved this Saturday afternoon between the two most holy days in the Christian calendar, Good Friday and Easter Sunday. Her favourite grandchild, Charles, Prince of Wales, had been informed too late that she was fading faster than anticipated. He was therefore unable to return from Clusters in Switzerland, where he had taken his sons for their annual skiing trip. And yet, while everyone who knew Charles and his grandmother felt that he would have dearly loved to be there with her, many who knew her believed that she actually would have preferred that he was not there at all. All her life, whether in the guise of the Honourable Elizabeth Bowes Lyon, Lady Elizabeth Bowes Lyon, the Duchess of York, Queen and Empress Consort Elizabeth, or Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, Elizabeth had recoiled from unpleasantness. Distressing scenes were more than anathema to her. She had spent her whole life actively avoiding them. Departing this life in the presence of the person she loved above all others on this earth would certainly have been distressing for both of them, and many people who knew her and the Prince of Wales well expressed the view that it had been merciful that he was absent. Indeed, in his excellent 2005 biography, Elizabeth the Queen Mother, the old Etonian author, Hugo Vickers, who did know her and had good contacts with the palace, even forwards the view that she might well have elected to die on the day she did, knowing that in doing so she would be sparing her grandson pain and others trouble. Fanciful though that view might seem, Elizabeth was such a determined woman that if anyone could have elected her time of death, it would have been her. She was a truly remarkable human being, with an awe-inspiring strength of character and indomitability of will. By her own admission, she was not as nice as people believed, which does not mean that she could not be, and frequently wasn't, very nice indeed. But there was steel beneath the velvet glove, as she herself acknowledged, and in the course of her long and eventful life she would have the scope to indulge all the aspects of her character, from the kindliest to the harshest. In so doing, she made herself into one of the most popular and, for a time, influential characters on the 20th century world stage. Although no one has ever said it before, the truth is, seldom in history has there been a public personage whose virtues and failings so perfectly suited the role she was called upon to play. and seldom in history has someone handled her role as effectively as Elizabeth did. Fortunately for her and for the British monarchy, Elizabeth had a unique set of attributes which meant that she became, when the occasion demanded it, an almost perfect evocation of the role of the idealized queen she strove to be. But beneath that exterior lay the human being with the unique mixture of virtues and failings which each of us possesses. No rendering of her story can be justly deemed complete without an examination of both her virtues and her failings, which have hitherto been either ignored entirely or then hinted at so obtusely that only those in the know can get even the obscurest hint of what the author is getting at. Elizabeth and the public both deserve better, especially now that she and many of the participants in her story have died. Character is destiny, as the ancient Greek philosopher Heraclitus observed, and the only way for any biographer to do justice to the life of a subject is to present a well-rounded picture of that individual. Elizabeth was undoubtedly a fascinating woman who lived an amazing life. While she was unquestionably a force for good much of the time, and while she made significant contributions not only to British national life during the nearly 79 years she occupied a public position, but also to the Western world during her glory days during the Second World War, both her life and her character were far more complex than her public image suggested. How she dealt with its demands, how her strengths and weaknesses affected her destiny and those surrounding her, is not the stuff of fairy tales, but of life. Though inevitably with royalty there is a fairy tale element to a fate so far removed from ordinary mankind, it does not behove anyone ever to think that royalty is anything but human. Prick their veins, and the blood invariably flows red. They are human just like everyone else, and their lives only become genuinely interesting when one can inspect them in their entirety. I hope that by examining Elizabeth's character and some of the hitherto unknown issues which shaped her, the listener will come to a fuller appreciation of her as a living, breathing individual who sought to shape her destiny and succeeded so brilliantly that she has gone down in history as one of the central characters of the 20th century. The Much-Wanted Angel, Chapter 1. The world into which Elizabeth Bowes Lyon was born on the 4th of August, 1900, was dramatically different in structure from the one in which she would live as an adult. It was a world of superficial certainties, with the rich man in his castle and the poor man at the gate. With the exception of France, all the major European powers were monarchies. The aristocracy held sway throughout that continent, even in Republican France, and certainly in England, where her father was the proud owner of a comfortable house called St. Paul's, Waldenbury in Hertfordshire, and in Scotland, where her grandfather, the 13th Earl of Strathmore and Kinghorn, occupied the ancient position of Thane of Glamis, the historic castle mentioned by Shakespeare in Macbeth. Across the water in America, the old and new elite also held sway, though there was more fluidity in society than there was in the old world. Certainly, some things would remain the same throughout her life. The English weather was as variable then as it is now. In July 1900, the southeast of England experienced a heatwave that left London's Hyde Park as scorched and dusty as it would become in 1976 and at the turn of the 21st century. Then, at the end of the month, the heatwave broke and cooler, more English weather returned to the parched environment, much to the relief of the citizens of London and the farmers in nearby Hertfordshire, where Elizabeth's main childhood home was situated. Beneath the apparent certainties, however, modernity, with all its impending sometimes violent changes, was already asserting itself, and nowhere more so than amongst the heads of state and royals who would, one day, be such a feature of the adult Elizabeth's world. On the 29th of July, King Umberto I of Italy became the first of a series of monarchs and their heirs to be assassinated in the new century, when he was shot four times at Monza by the Italian-American anarchist Gaetano Bresci. The ancient Romans, with their belief in omens, would doubtless have thought, erroneously as it turned out, that the week of Elizabeth's birth was so unlucky for royalty that no marriage should ever be countenanced between her and a royal. The day after Umberto's assassination, on the 30th of July 1900, Queen Victoria's second son, Alfred, firstly Duke of Edinburgh, latterly Duke of Coburg, succumbed to throat cancer at the relatively early age of 55 at Schloss Rosenau, his castle in his duchy of Coburg. This death would have a long-standing impact upon Elizabeth's adult life, partly because his namesake son and heir had died following a suicide attempt the year before, leaving the duchy with no direct heir. Coburg was a hallowed place in Queen Victoria's eyes, and the aged queen was still very much the matriarch of Europe. Her beloved consort Albert had been a Coburg prince, as indeed had been her uncle King Leopold of the Belgians and her own mother, all of whom had been brought up at Rosenau. She therefore viewed the role of Duke of Coburg with rather more importance than it warranted. When her third son, the Duke of Connaught, and his heir, Prince Arthur, declined the dubious honour of becoming Coburg's ruler, Victoria foisted it upon her fatherless 16-year-old grandson, Charles Edward, Duke of Albany. This unfortunate young man did not want to leave his mother, sister, and country. He had never known his father, Victoria's fourth and youngest son, Prince Leopold, who had died of haemophilia prior to his birth, with the result that Charles Edward had the distinction of being born a royal duke instead of a mere prince. Lacking the more necessary protection of a father would prove to be a disadvantage throughout his life, which was, off any interpretation, unfortunate for someone who had been born a British prince and royal duke. How Elizabeth would cope with this cousin of her husband's when she became queen says much about her character and the forces that drove it, but all of this was still in the future when Coburg found itself without a reigning duke in the week of her birth. What was very much in the present was the third adverse royal omen within a week. Days after the death of the Duke of Coburg, the Qajar Shah of Persia, Mozaffar ad-Din, who was visiting Paris for the 1900 World Expo Trade Fair, narrowly escaped death at the hands of an anarchist. It is interesting to speculate to what extent Elizabeth's future life would have been different if Solson had succeeded in his attempted regicide. Certainly, it would have been poorer, for the Shah's demise would have prevented him from signing the concession with William Knox Darcy in 1901, which proved to be so advantageous to British financial interests, but so economically disastrous to the Persians. If Elizabeth was born in a week of tumult, her birth itself would prove to be rather more multifaceted than it appeared to be on its face. The official version, which remained static for 80 years, was straightforward enough. In it, she was born at St. Paul's Waldenbury in Hertfordshire, England, on the 4th of August 1900, the ninth child and fourth daughter of Lord and Lady Glamis. Her father, Claude, was, as we have seen, the heir to the 13th Earl of Strathmore and Kinghorn, while his wife, Cecilia, had been born a Cavendish Bentinck, with all that implied to the Conoscenti. Despite being untitled, and with a father who was a mere reverend, Cecilia was undoubtedly of illustrious lineage, Cavendish Bentinck being the surname of the Dukes of Portland. Her great-grandfather had been Prime Minister twice during George III's reign and had the doubtful distinction of being the only Prime Minister of England never to have spoken in Parliament. But for the rule of primogeniture, which prevented females from succeeding to most English titles, she would have succeeded her uncle, who inherited the dukedom sideways and became the fifth duke. Instead of which, all but one of the following dukes failed to have male heirs, and the title died out with the ninth and last duke, Victor, in 1990, his son having predeceased him. By then, the Portland dukedom was somewhat remote from Elizabeth, who is not on record as having expressed any regret at the termination of such an illustrious ducal house. While purists might have looked to Victor's divorce from his first wife, Clotilde, as the reason for her apparent disinterest, those who knew Elizabeth well understood that his divorced status had nothing to do with her attitude, which, contrary to popular belief, was remarkably tolerant of divorce within her social circle. Lurking in her family cupboard, however, was a secret so dark and damaging that it provides an easy answer to her indifference to the fate of the dukedom of Portland, while also explaining why she spent her whole life ignoring the circumstances of her birth when she could, and when she could not, succumbed to such pathological hatred that her normal equanimity and serenity were replaced with a cold and dreadful vengeance. The first and least significant mystery of Elizabeth's birth is her birthplace. This in itself was unusual, indeed extraordinary, for in the ordinary course of events, aristocratic ladies of that time invariably gave birth at home. Had a caesarean been necessary, there might have been justification for an expectant mother to be transported by one of the horse-drawn ambulances then prevalent to a hospital, though even such a step was highly unusual. Lady Glamis, however, produced all her children naturally. Certainly all the children born before Elizabeth entered the world, in true aristocratic fashion, at home. Elizabeth, however, was not born at home. Indeed, no one has ever been able to determine with certainty where she actually entered the world. If she herself knew, she made sure she obfuscated to such an extent that the only conclusion one could come to was that she was willfully sowing seeds of confusion. To one lady in waiting, she said, "I might have been born in the back of a taxi." A truly preposterous notion, for there were no circumstances which could justify Lady Glamis delivering an infant in a taxi, as any well-bred person knew only too well. To her page, William Tallon, Elizabeth provided the slightly more plausible hypothesis of being born in the back of a horse-drawn ambulance. However, neither of these versions made much sense, for her birth was not an emergency. It was not treated as such. It was never stated to be such, nor was Lady Glamis laid up after it, as she would have been for an extensive period, in keeping with contemporaneous medical custom. Despite filling out papers for her passport in 1921, stating that she had been born in London, in 1937, Elizabeth herself unveiled a plaque which categorically commemorated her birthplace and christening as having taken place in the parish of All Saints Parish Church, St. Paul's Walden. Her official biographer, William Shawcross, observes, with some merit, that no comment by her seems to have survived as to why St. Paul's Walden was officially listed as her birthplace, or why she willingly unveiled a plaque containing wrong information. The reason, as he might well have known, and if he did not, he ought to have, was a concerted and fully understandable attempt by the lady in question to keep her darkest secret out of the public domain. The matter of Elizabeth's birthplace was, in fact, only one of the questions relating to her birth. The actual date of her birth was also open to question. Kindly biographers such as Hugo Vickers have forwarded the theory that she took care to adhere to the official date of the 4th of August in an attempt to limit the damage an alteration would have caused. The prospect of a queen consort of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland admitting that her official birth date was in fact incorrect would have caused havoc, not just amongst the many official bodies whose functions overlapped or intersected with hers, and would consequently necessitate changing not only records, but also dates of celebration and the host of other paraphernalia which go along with being royal. The fact that it would also have opened up awkward questions as to why someone whose lineage was as eminent as Elizabeth's could possibly have been given the wrong birth date was, of course, glossed over. And for good reason, as the simple fact is that such questions would have driven the whole wretched question into the discomforting territory of truthfulness. In July 1980, in the run-up to the official celebrations for Elizabeth's 80th birthday, the issue seemed in danger of erupting embarrassingly. According to the fable, which was promulgated at the time, preparations for the celebrations the following month were well in hand when a parishioner at All Saints, the parish church for St. Paul's Waldenbury, noticed that her birthplace had been omitted from the relevant literature despite the presence of the plaque. In the 57 years since Elizabeth had become royal, no one had ever publicly questioned the anomalies surrounding her birth. Now an inquiry of her household as to why St. Paul's Waldenbury had been omitted presented them with the possibility that the circumstances surrounding her birth were in danger of being made public. Realizing that the submerged part of the iceberg was infinitely more damaging than the tip, and knowing only too well that there was every possibility that the main story had reached the ears of the press, who had concocted the tale of the sharp-eyed parishioner as a cover for deeper ferreting out of the facts, Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother's household, wisely decided to divert the press's attention away from the embarrassing underbelly of the burg by dishing up the news of its tip. Rather than issuing a repetition of the fiction, which had been purveyed to the public since 1923, that she had been born at St. Paul's Waldenbury, Clarence House therefore issued an announcement to the effect that Her Majesty had been born in London and not in Hertfordshire, as the official line had been for the previous decades. As anyone with any knowledge of the media knows, an admission of this magnitude is sure to create enough of a splash to satisfy those who require coverage, while silencing those who theorise that there might well have been more to the iceberg than met the eye. Although there was never much likelihood of the average reporter in Britain, or anywhere else for that matter, having heard the stories about Elizabeth's birth, there were one or two well-born or well-married journalists who had to have known of them. However, such was Queen Elizabeth the Queen Mother's popularity that even had they been tempted to take the matter further, their editors, all of whom enjoyed lunches at the palace with the Queen, would never have jeopardised the cordiality of their relations with their sovereign by publishing such incendiary news about her mother. For the fact is, royal and aristocratic circles had been alight for decades with the story that Elizabeth Bowes Lyon, while undoubtedly the daughter of the 14th Earl of Strathmore and Kinghorn, was not the child of his wife Cecilia, nor was her younger brother David, born nearly 2 years after her, on the 2nd of May 1902. The two Benjamins, as they were known in the Bowes Lyon family, in a biblical allusion to the brother of Joseph, who was himself the product of a coupling between his father and his mother's maid, were supposedly the children of Marguerite Rodier, an attractive and pleasant Frenchwoman who had been the cook at St. Paul's Waldenbury, and is meant to have provided Lord and Lady Glamis with the two children they so yearned for after Cecilia was forbidden by her doctors from producing any more progeny. Hence the nickname of Cookie, which the Duke and Duchess of Windsor took care to promulgate throughout international society once Elizabeth proved herself to be their most formidable enemy. This early version of surrogacy, if surrogacy it was, might have been unusual, but there was nothing extraordinary or unheard of about it in aristocratic circles. In 1900, adoption was not a regulated practice, but primarily a personal arrangement pursued by those who wanted children and those who did not. There was none of the bureaucracy which exists today. If you wanted to adopt a child and its parents agreed, you drew up documents, signed them, and that child was legally yours. In many of the European monarchies, titles could be passed down from adoptive parents to adopted children. For instance, in 1847, Elzéar, 1st Duke de Sabran, adopted the child of his wife's second cousin, Count Marc de Pontivez Bargem. One of his descendants is the present Duchesse d'Orléans, a member of the French royal family. The late Maharaja of Jaipur was adopted by his heirless predecessor, and Prince Jonathan Doria Pamphili was adopted by his mother, Princess Orietta Doria Pamphili, and her husband, Commander Frank Pogson, as late as 1963. In Britain, however, adopted children, like illegitimate children, could not and still cannot succeed to peerages. Worse still, they were prevented from using the courtesy titles that ordinarily devolved upon the younger children of a peer. There were some notable anomalies which caused much distress to the individuals involved. The writer, Anthony Haden Guest, despite being the elder son of the fourth Lord Haden Guest, was subjected to the constant reminder that his birth had preceded his parents' marriage by being denied the honorific of the Honourable. In a world where titles counted and everyone knew who did and did not have one, this was an unnecessary humiliation to inflict upon anyone. What made it even worse, however, was the fact that his younger brother Christopher, the husband of the movie star Jamie Lee Curtis, was an Honourable from birth, their parents having married by this time and would ultimately succeed to the barony. This was a humiliation shared by the actress Nimmie March, the adopted daughter of the Duke and Duchess of Richmond and Gordon, who remained in private life Miss Naomi Gordon Lennox. The four children of the fourth Marquess and Marchioness of Aberdeen and Temer fared no better. Subjected to perpetual reminders of their adoptive status by remaining the Mrs. Mary and Sarah Gordon and Messrs. Andrew and James Gordon, while all their relations had titles, their mother June became increasingly vociferous in her condemnation of a practice that remained a thorn in all adoptive children's sides. It was one thing for adopted children to elect to inform others of their adoptive status, and quite another to have that fact declared at all times to all and sundry, whether they wished it to be or not. Being the founder and musical director of the famed Haddo House Choral and Operatic Society, and something of a powerhouse, June Aberdeen was in an ideal position to make her voice heard, and heard she made it. She lived to see the fruit of her labours rewarded, when, on the 30th of April 2004, Queen Elizabeth II issued a royal warrant giving all adoptive children the right to use the same courtesy titles as the natural children of peers. Prior to the issuing of that royal warrant, adoptive children were forced to live as second-class citizens in a first-class world. Of course, their parents usually minded as much as the children themselves, for adoptive parents often love their adopted children at least as much as, and often more than, the children whom nature has imposed upon them, as I know from my own personal experience. It is hardly surprising, therefore, that aristocrats who wanted children, or more children, as is supposed to have been the case with Claude and Cecilia Glamis, sometimes went to extreme lengths to ensure that their offspring were born without the stigma of inequality. The legal principle of presumption of legitimacy worked in the favour of such couples because a child who was born within a valid marriage was deemed to be the legitimate product of both parties to that union. As long as the child was acknowledged officially by both parents as their natural-born issue, it automatically assumed the rank, style, and title that was the due of all legitimate children of peers. This practice worked not only for adopted children whose parents were intent on ensuring that they went through life with the privileges of legitimate issue, but also to the benefit of philandering wives or wives whose husbands could not produce children but wanted them. The aristocracy was rife with these children, and the way Elizabeth would treat them throughout her years as queen consort and queen mother, often in direct contradiction of her espoused values and the way she treated everyone else, goes some way to confirming the rumours about her birth. For instance, the 8th Duke of Rutland's sculptress wife, Violet, gave birth in 1892 to a beautiful little girl who was known from birth as Lady Diana Manners, despite being Mr. Henry Harry Cust's daughter. Her actual paternity made no difference to her status, and she would go down in history as the fabled Lady Diana Cooper, wife of the British ambassador to France, Duff Cooper, and one of the few people who would curtsy to the Duchess of Windsor and remain on cordial terms with Elizabeth. Another notable jacket, as such babies were known in the circles which had need of them, whose life interwove with Elizabeth's, was the 7th Earl of Carnarvon. His ancestral home, Highclere Castle, was famous for the Tutankhamun treasures it had housed since the time of his birth in 1924, and is now even more famous for being the setting for the hit television series Downton Abbey. His father, Henry, also known as Porchy, after his courtesy title Lord Porchester, was a famous roué and raconteur who entertained both society and the masses with two volumes of memoirs and countless television and radio interviews, which might have been embarrassing to his family, but were a study in hilarity for everyone else. I knew him slightly, albeit to my regret when he talked me out of backing Ile de Bourbon during Royal Ascot in the 1970s, and it romped home, while Porchy's certainty lagged sadly behind. Short and rather attractive in an ugly sort of way, because his captivating personality more than made up for the irregularity of his features, he was supposedly sterile. His son and heir, another Henry, also known as Porchy, except to his father's friends, who then had to make the distinction between Big Porchy and Little Porchy, was his physical antithesis. Little Porchy was tall and strapping, indisputably handsome, with regular features and a gravity of manner that was sorely at odds with Big Porchy's levity. There was also a daughter, Lady Anne Penelope Herbert, born in 1925 to his American first wife, Anne Wendell, after which there were no further children, even though the marriage lasted until 1936. This in itself was noteworthy. In a day and age before antibiotics, when children frequently died in childhood from minor infections, and sole heirs stood a sufficiently great chance of being killed in a war to necessitate at least a spare or two, couples who had only one or two children often delivered the message that there was a problem within the marriage. This might be that the wife did not like sex, or that the husband was infertile, or that something had gone wrong with her childbearing capacity. The grander the couple, the more likely that there was a serious problem, for great estates were entailed upon the title, meaning that a peer could not leave his property to whom he pleased. It had to be inherited by the next holder of the title, irrespective of whether that was his eldest son or third cousin twice removed, as often happened. So there was a strong incentive for a couple to produce enough children for the title not to go sideways to some distant cousin. The aristocracy was filled with horror stories about widows and daughters of great peers living in penury while some distant cousin was lording it over them in more ways than one. This paucity of children indicating a problem was certainly true in the case of the Carnarvons, and their situation is worthy of examination, if only because it was redolent of so much in Elizabeth's circumstances. 3 years after the American Countess divorced the Earl in 1936, Big Porchy married Tilly Losch, the celebrated Austrian dancer, actress and artist, whose first husband had been the Anglo-American multimillionaire art patron, Edward James. Marrying her was indicative of Porchy's strength of character, for by then King George VI and Queen Elizabeth sat on the English throne. Following the abdication of King Edward VIII, divorce, which had been steadily gaining acceptance in all social circles, once more resulted in ostracism, especially when the wife was deemed to be the guilty party, and Tilly Losch had been ascribed guilt in the most scandalous divorce case of its day, Edward James having divorced her for adultery, citing Tsar Alexander II's tall and handsome son-in-law, Prince Serge Obolensky, after she had thrown over the lover of whom he approved, the Honourable Thomas, Tom Mitford, brother of the famous Mitford girls and heir to Lord Ribblesdale. But what made the James divorce particularly scandalous was that Tilly had cross-petitioned, alleging that her husband was a homosexual, which he was well known to be within transatlantic society, at a time when homosexuality was illegal on both sides of the Atlantic. When her petition failed, she had a serious nervous breakdown and had to be hospitalised in Switzerland, whence she was rescued by the charming and deliciously unorthodox Porchy. There was no progeny from this marriage, a fact which Tilly Losch made no bones about. She matter-of-factly stated on many an occasion that her husband was sterile and had always been, following a bout of post-puberty mumps. Although she was occasionally warned by friends to tone down her comments, lest she call into question the legitimacy of the heir, she seems never to have done so, nor to have thought that she was endangering the future of the Carnarvon earldom with what, on the face of it, seemed to be blatant indiscretion. In that regard, she was correct, for society was littered with children whose legitimacy owed everything to presumption and nothing to genetics, and there was no prospect at all of anyone challenging little Porchy's right to the Carnarvon title and estates. There was an unexpected postscript which shows how accommodating Elizabeth was behind what became her professed veneer of rectitude. Although Porchy and Tilly were somewhat racy and deemed to be that bit too openly scandalous to be embraced by Bertie and herself, once they were the king and queen, his son and heir was accepted unreservedly. As he grew towards adulthood, little Porchy became rather chummy with Lilibet, as Princess Elizabeth, the heiress to the throne, was known within her family circle. Towards the end of the Second World War, while she was writing to Prince Philip of Greece as a prospective beau, but nothing had been agreed between them either formally or informally, Lilibet began to see rather a lot of Porchy. Highclere Castle was relatively near to Windsor Castle, where the young princesses spent most of the war. Queen Elizabeth, who much preferred British aristocrats to royals of any persuasion, liked Porchy and had nothing against a prospective union between him and her elder daughter. On the other hand, she made it clear that she disliked the possibility of a marriage between her daughter and Philip, to whom she referred disparagingly as the Hun. King George VI, however, watched the budding friendship with growing horror, and when it became apparent that it was in danger of blossoming into a fully-fledged romance, took active steps to discourage it. "She cannot marry a man when no one knows who his father is," he is alleged to have said to one relation, while to another he said, "Young Porchester is charming, but there is no possibility of my condoning a union between a daughter of mine and a butler's son." George VI was giving voice to the methods adopted by a trio of society doctors whose success had been much enhanced by their talent for assisting childless peeresses to produce the heirs their husbands needed. Doctors Abrams, Ahrens, and Zimmerman were fashionable obstetricians and gynecologists who had an infallible technique for providing peeresses with these much-needed miracles. The ladies in question would attend their surgeries in Harley Street. In an adjoining room would be one of the handsome, strapping butlers who were on the doctor's payroll as sperm donors. After these men had ejaculated, their semen was taken next door and injected into the lady in question, who was spread-eagled with a speculum awaiting her chance of a miracle. Lady and donor would never meet. No one but the doctor would know who the natural father was. But what everyone in society knew was that, his good looks aside, the butler in question would be of superior genetic stock, the proud possessor of intelligence and organizational skills without which he could never have risen to such a responsible position. While nowadays people might think of butlers as being servants who were unctuous twits gliding around large houses, opening doors and serving drinks, the reality was different. Butlers were, in effect, the managing directors of households at a time when many were larger than most companies. To function in their allotted role, they had to possess native intelligence, organizational skills, management abilities, discipline, a steady temperament, and the social aptitude to deal ably with their superiors, equals, and inferiors. In other words, they were the top-flight executives of their day. While they undoubtedly came from more disadvantaged backgrounds than their masters, they were often their human equals and sometimes their human superiors. Not, of course, that either side would have been foolhardy enough to acknowledge such a reality. Many of them were also handsome, for some were hired as much for their good looks as for their other abilities. Moreover, because of their inferior social status, they would never have the means or the prestige to cause future problems for the women impregnated with their semen. This proved to be a brilliant solution to the problems of many childless aristocrats, especially in a world where inbreeding had sometimes created unfortunate physical or personal characteristics. Claude Glamis, however, had no problem fathering children, as his wife Cecilia had proven 8 times over. Nor did she have problems producing healthy, happy, good-looking and charming children. However, one of those tragedies which periodically happened in those pre-antibiotic days might well have been at the root of the problem. On the 17th of October, 1893, Claude and Cecilia Glamis' eldest child, Violet, died of heart failure following a bout of diphtheria. Cecilia had given birth to her youngest son, Michael, less than 3 weeks before, on the 1st of October, 1893. According to all sources, Lady Glamis was an exceptionally loving mother who lived primarily for her children. Already emotionally vulnerable following the latest birth, she was devastated by the death of this child, whom she always said was beautiful, and admitted till her dying day to missing. In Queen Elizabeth the Queen Mother, the official biography, William Shawcross euphemistically states that Lady Glamis bore her daughter's loss with as much courage as she could muster. The fact is, she suffered a severe nervous breakdown from which she never entirely recovered. She would always remain fragile, both physically and personally, and while she recovered sufficiently to resume her role in society, she was prone to nervous attacks which incapacitated her for the remainder of her life. At times like these, she would withdraw, not from family life, but from everything else. During the First World War, after the death of one son and the loss of another, who would turn out to have been captured, her health became so precarious that the teenage Elizabeth often had to step into her mother's shoes and fill the role of chatelaine of Glamis Castle for her. She would also rather touchingly wake up early and intercept the post in case it contained bad news for which she would then need to prepare her mother. One cannot help but sympathise with a woman who so loves her children that she cannot fully come to terms with the loss of one. Whether Cecilia went on to have two more children, as the official sources state, or whether she was so damaged by the loss of her firstborn that she was not allowed to put herself through the trauma of giving birth yet again, one fact is indisputable. For 7 years, St. Paul's Waldenbury saw no more births. According to the rumours that were so prolific that it is almost miraculous they remained within the narrow confines of aristocratic circles for so long, as more and more time elapsed after the death of Violet, both Claude and Cecilia Glamis wanted more children. In those days, however, doctors were even more convinced than they would be today that a woman whose health was fragile should not expose herself to the biological and emotional changes pregnancy inevitably brings in its wake. This view had a degree of merit, for the hormonal changes of pregnancy can induce postpartum depression in even a healthy woman. For someone like Cecilia Glamis, who had failed to recover fully from the grief of losing a child, the risks of pregnancy were adjudged to be too great. According to the Duke of Windsor, who had access to all the reports when he was king, and had moreover known of the background while Prince of Wales, through his brother Bertie, Claude and Cecilia resorted to a primitive form of surrogacy, whose existence is as old as civilization itself. This method had the merit of possessing the Bible's stamp of approval. Cecilia, it must be remembered, was the daughter of an Anglican minister of religion, her father having been the Reverend Charles Cavendish Bentinck. She was schooled and steeped in the Bible, and would ensure that all her children were too. In that more God-fearing age, when scripture lessons were an integral part of all children's education, and biblical stories were far more commonly known than they are today, both she and Claude would have known from Genesis about Sarah saying to Abraham about her maid, Hagar, "Sleep with my maidservant, perhaps I can build a family through her." And of Rachel saying to Jacob, "Here is Bilhah, my maidservant. Sleep with her so that she can bear children for me, and that through her I too can build a family." Joseph, the product of that surrogacy, enjoys fame to this day, if only through the musical Joseph and His Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, though people like Claude and Cecilia Glamis would not have needed Andrew Lloyd Webber to be aware that the arrangement was such a success that Joseph became his father's favourite child. This biblical stamp of approval cannot be exaggerated, especially with people like Claude and Cecilia, who were devout Christians. When a man lay with his wife's maidservant for the purposes of providing them with a child, he was not having an affair, nor was he being unfaithful. He was implanting his seed in the finest tradition of Abraham and Jacob. As such, his actions had been sanctioned by God, for Genesis makes it clear that neither Abraham nor Jacob was breaking the commandment against adultery while lying with Hagar and Bila. Moreover, the family had form, and relatively recent form at that, with an Earl of Strathmore having issue with a maid. Claude's great-uncle John Lyon Bowes, the 10th Earl, had met Mary Milner, the daughter of a local gardener, while staying at a hunting lodge near Streatham, one of the two large County Durham estates in northern England, which had come into the family when his father, John Lyon, the 9th Earl, had married one of the greatest heiresses in England, Mary Eleanor Bowes. After that, he and the family were known as Lyon Bowes for the next two generations, before switching the order of the names to the more familiar Bowes Lyon. Mary Eleanor Bowes was one of the richest women in the 18th century, having been left the immense fortune of £1 million as a little girl by her father, with the proviso that whoever married her had to adopt the name Bowes to share in her wealth. Mary Eleanor's son, John Lyon Bowes, being one of the richest young men in the kingdom, as well as the possessor of the great and ancient Scottish titles of Strathmore and Glamis, was in the position to do as he pleased, and prior to meeting Mary Milner, the woman who pleased him was the wild, captivating, and equally rich, but decidedly married, Sarah, Countess of Tyrconnell. She ran off with him to Gibside Hall, the magnificent Jacobean stately home in County Durham, which his mother had inherited from her father. This caused a major scandal, which was widely reported in the newspapers at the time, though by then the English public was used to scandals concerning the family, for his mother had also been the subject of a major scandal, which is better recounted elsewhere. While Sarah had achieved celebrity status when her affair with Prince Frederick, Duke of York, hit the tabloids. Although she and John loved each other, theirs was a star-crossed union, for she died of consumption aged 37 at Gibside Hall. It was during the period that John was grieving for Sarah that the darkly attractive Mary Milner caught his eye. Notwithstanding that she was uneducated and unacceptable in the social circles in which the Bowes and Lyon families moved, he struck up a relationship with her that quickly deepened into something so profound that, against all the odds, he set her up in a house in London. There they lived in connubial, if unmarried, bliss. She produced a son whom they named John Milner Bowes, itself shocking for the time, as earls simply did not live openly with servant girls or name their bastards after themselves. This action, however, was an indication of the depth of feeling John Senior had for John Junior, as well as for the boy's mother. Soon he took another unprecedented step, settling a large sum of money upon the son of whom he was inordinately fond. When John Junior was 9, John Senior, realizing that he was dying, took yet more unprecedented steps to ensure the boy's future. He left him all his English and Scottish estates, and despite having to go to elaborate lengths to execute his objective, married Mary. He was plainly hoping that by doing so he would not only secure his beloved Mary's future, but also that of their son. He had to be held up during the marriage ceremony and died the following day, fully intending that John Junior would succeed him as the 11th Earl of Strathmore. His younger brother, Thomas, Claude's grandfather, was having none of it, however. As far as he was concerned, he was the only rightful heir to the earldom, thanage, and all the estates and property entailed upon them. He promptly laid claim to the lot. After protracted legal proceedings, Thomas was found to be the rightful heir to the title, illegitimate children, as we have previously heard, not being able to inherit titles even after their legitimisation. All the property that was entailed upon the earldom of Strathmore, the Scottish Lyon, part of the family's heritage, went to him, while all the English Bowes property, which John Senior had been legally free to dispose of as he wished, went to John Junior. This separation of the Bows and Lyon parts of the family's patrimony meant that the earls had overnight ceased to be immensely rich, for the lion's share of their fortune had been Bows, not Lyon. Fortunately for the family, however, John Milner Bowes did not have any children. When he died in 1885, all his properties united once more under the umbrella of the earldom, which by then was held by Elizabeth's grandfather. However, John had spent much of his money amassing a vast art collection, which he left, together with a museum to house it, to the public, so Elizabeth's family would never be as rich again as they had been before the Scottish and English properties had been split in two. If ever a family had had a lesson in the importance of keeping on the right side of the legal divide, where illegitimacy, legitimization, and congress between earls and servant girls were concerned, the Strathmores had. The fact that all had ended relatively well did not obviate the need to remember the lessons of the past, chief amongst which was the need for discretion. In Victorian England, even more so than in the more liberal Georgian times, it was not what you did, but what you admitted to, that made the difference between a smooth, socially acceptable life or a bumpy, unacceptable one. Although John Bowes had been a fine and very rich gentleman, even his legitimization had not rendered him the equal of his significantly poorer Lyon relations. Jackets of any description, whether the issue of a peeress and her lover, or the illegitimate issue of a lord and his surrogate, must be passed off as legitimate progeny. The alternative, of an open declaration of illegitimacy, was unthinkable. The illegitimate children of aristocrats did not enjoy the status of aristocrats, even if both their parents were aristocrats. They endured the status of a lower class of person, even if they were well off financially. Caught somewhere between the lower classes and the impoverished gentry, they belonged to no world at a time when social position was a point fixed at birth and unchangeable till death. The progeny of an aristocrat and a servant were in an even more invidious position, for they were perceived to be of the rank of their non-aristocratic parent. The only exceptions to this rule were officially recognized royal bastards, but since Lord and Lady Glamis were not royal, and there was no prospect of their elevating any bastard the way Charles II had created the Dukes of St. Albans, Grafton, and Monmouth, or the way King William IV had successfully ennobled Mrs. Jordan's Fitzclarence brood, there was only one solution. Elizabeth had to be seen to be legitimate. The solution was simple enough. In a day and age when women withdrew from social life once they started to show, it was relatively easy for surrogacies to proceed without remark, for few people would see a woman as she approached her term. Without the need to pad or otherwise indulge in straightforward deception, the main hurdle to discovery would be at the birth itself. Because babies were customarily born at home, it would be difficult to dupe a midwife or doctor when, of course, she or he would know exactly what the mistress of the house looked like. On the other hand, if the midwife or doctor were complicit, there was the possibility, no matter how remote, of trust being violated in the future. It therefore reduced the possibilities for vulnerability and made more sense for the baby to be born away from home, delivered preferably by someone who did not know either the birth or putative mother. In such a situation, a midwife would be preferable to a doctor. She was a lower class than a doctor, and as such, a lesser threat for the future. Furthermore, midwives usually performed a specific function, namely assisting at a birth, and only at the birth, while doctors had more all-encompassing relationships with their patients. And in such a situation, the more involved the relationship, the more likelihood of word getting out, Hippocratic oath or none. What militated in favour of the anonymous midwife over the known doctor was that there was nothing suspicious about a midwife being called to attend upon a woman whom she did not know and who had been taken in labour suddenly. Midwives were well used to being called out at all hours of the day and night to women they knew well, slightly, or not at all. There was nothing suspicious about a woman going into labour unexpectedly when she was far away from home. In such a situation, the midwife would be as quickly in and out as the birth required. Her job did not involve checking on the mother afterwards or attesting to the birth, or in any other way assuming the vigilance that contemporary midwives adopt. They really were delivery merchants, pure and simple, and for that reason it made good sense that the babies born to one woman but passed off as the fruit of another womb should be delivered by someone without the resources to check upon the mother in the future, or indeed necessarily to know who the mother actually was. Human nature being what it is, however, the trusting will trust. And who better to trust than your own doctor? Dr. Bernard Thomas, a general practitioner in Wellen, which was the town nearest to St. Paul's Walden, is alleged to have claimed to have been present at the birth, although there is no proof one way or the other that he actually did make this claim. Canon Dendel French, the chaplain at Glam's Castle, who was previously the vicar at All Saints, St. Paul's Walden, took it upon himself to launch his own investigations in the hope of arriving at the truth. Aware that there were sufficient claims from locals at St. Paul's Walden to rule out London as the likely birthplace, he contacted a compos mentis and youthful 91-year-old spinster, Miss Margaret Valentine, whose father, the Reverend Henry Valentine, had been the vicar who christened Elizabeth in September 1900. She recollected that she had been practising the piano at the vicarage when a maid came over from the Bury, as the big house was known locally, to say that Lady Glam's had given birth to a baby girl. She claimed to have asked her if this had been at the Bury, and the maid confirmed that that was where the birth had taken place. Without intending in any way to disparage Miss Valentine's veracity, one has to wonder how likely it was that a young girl would have found it necessary to nail down the place of birth so pointedly by asking if it had specifically taken place at the house. That is the sort of question one asks only if one knows that one has not been provided with full or accurate information. It is not the sort of question a young girl asks a maid who has just informed her that the birth did indeed take place at the very place she is now cross-examining her about. In a court of law, this is the sort of detail which would raise a huge red flag for a competent attorney or judge, and there is no reason for the listener to view Miss Valentine's account as anything but an elderly lady's clumsy but understandable attempt to lay the ghosts of the past to rest before they come back to haunt the living, for Elizabeth was still very much alive at that time. While it is entirely credible that the maid did indeed walk over to the vicarage to announce the birth of the baby, and while it is even more likely that she would have informed them that Lady Glam's was the mother, this does not actually prove that the birth took place at the Bury, or indeed that Cecilia was the individual who gave birth. All it proves is that the maid was sent over to the vicarage to give the Valentines the good news of Elizabeth's birth, which, if it was a surrogacy, would certainly have required the family to provide disinformation for the staff to spread. Bad as Canon French's investigations were proving to be, worse was to follow. He uncovered the existence of quite a lot of gossip in the village, all of which both he and William Shawcross neglect to recount in the official biography, save for the rumour that Lady Glam's had actually been en route from London when the contractions began, and that the birth had taken place in or near Wellen. One story passed down, but acknowledged as only hearsay, was that the baby started to arrive en route from London and that Lady Glamis was taken to Dr. Thomas's home, Bridge House, Wellin, where the infant was delivered. At the same time, one of Canon French's elderly parishioners told him that her aunt had been in charge of the laundry at the Berry, and her work made her certain that the birth had taken place there. These conflicting versions present difficulties for the rational. Firstly, Lady Glamis had produced 8 children prior to 1900. It was therefore extremely unlikely that she would have been travelling between London and St. Paul's, Walden, on or near her due date. This is not the sort of behaviour anyone with considerable experience of childbirth would have indulged in, especially someone who was as devoted to her family as Cecilia Glamis. Remember, in 1900, there were no luxurious automobiles to ferry even the aristocracy between London and the country. There were trains and there were carriages. The former were comfortable, the latter far less so. No woman in her right mind would have been subjecting herself to the danger of a bumpy ride in even a well-sprung carriage, nor would she have been boarding a train at that late stage of her pregnancy. On the other hand, if the objective was to conceal the truth of what had actually taken place, obfuscation in the form of various and conflicting versions of the same event was singularly sensible. By tying up everyone in knots so that no one knew what to believe, the secret could be, if not exactly kept, then certainly retained sufficiently so that no one would know quite where the truth lay. However, some people did know the truth. Chief amongst these was Elizabeth's brother-in-law, David, the man who, as Prince of Wales, was one of her closest friends and greatest supporters, and who always paved the way for her and his younger brother, Bertie. As King Edward VIII, David had access to all the information about Elizabeth's secret, which was not so secret in aristocratic and royal circles. When he discovered, to his horror, that Elizabeth was actively scheming with his own courtiers to undermine his position as king and prevent him from marrying the woman he loved, he used the wealth of access at his disposal to circumvent his own private and deputy private secretaries and obtain sight of the documents, which confirmed that Elizabeth had been born not on the 4th of August, as supposed, but on the 3rd of August at St. Paul's Waldenbury to Marguerite Rodier. Unfortunately for all concerned, she arrived slightly earlier than anticipated. Lady Glamis was still in London and had to hightail it down to St. Paul's Waldenbury. She did indeed stop off at Dr. Thomas's house in Wellin, after which she was taken to the Berry, where she met her youngest daughter for the first time. Both Strathmores had faith in their doctors, for later, when he was dying, Claude confided in Dr. Ailes, who was attending to him in Scotland, that Elizabeth and David had indeed been born to the cook, though the sentiments he conveyed are best left for later in this work. Meanwhile, as Cecilia was familiarising herself with her latest daughter, her husband was in Scotland preparing for the glorious 12th, the opening of the grouse season. He would not come down south for some weeks thereafter. The Duke of Windsor always maintained that he would never have revealed Elizabeth's secret had he not discovered at the time of the abdication crisis through Lord Beaverbrook that Elizabeth was behind the scurrilous and utterly untrue rumour that Wallis had learnt secret sexual techniques in a bordello in China, and it was this which was the secret hold she had over King Edward VIII. Once he knew this to be true, however, he felt justified in rumbling the sister-in-law who had a secret of her own, and one, moreover, which had, in his view, more merit than the one she had invented about his beloved. Thereafter, Elizabeth was known as Cookie. For those who asked, as I did when I was a late teenager, why she was being called by that nickname, there was always a member of the Windsor Circle willing and able to recount how the high and mighty Princess Elizabeth, Queen of the United Kingdom and Northern Ireland, Empress of India, Queen of Canada, Australia, etc., etc., was not even legitimate, but the daughter of the 13th Earl of Strathmore and Kinghorn, and St. Paul's Waldenberry's cook, Mademoiselle Marguerite Rodière. Whether this was indeed the case, none of us will ever know definitively, unless DNA studies are done on Elizabeth and Cecilia to establish whether they shared a genetic link. In the absence of them, however, the behaviour of Elizabeth tends to support the claims of the Duke of Windsor and Dr. Ailes. Why else would she assert that she was born in London, as she did consistently in latter years? The answer is simple. She knew that she was born at St. Paul's Waldenberry. Even if she did not know about the laundress's claim to have washed the sheets, she would have known that the laundress would have seen bloodied sheets and would, in the nature of things, have reported on the state of the linen to the other servants. Anyone who has had servants knows they gossip. It is easier to conceal a secret from a spouse than a servant, and no amount of aristocratic rising above the gossip silences the inevitable garrulousness. Elizabeth must also have known that the local village was awash with gossip to the effect that she and her brother David were not born to Lady Glamis, but to Marguerite Rodière, and moreover, that changing her birth date from the 4th to the 3rd of August would have rendered it impossible for Cecilia to have given birth to her. It is unlikely that she would have welcomed the intervention of Dr. Thomas, who, tellingly, is meant to have maintained that he was present at her birth, without actually stating who the mother was. All this meant that the only way to keep her secret was to maintain that she had been born in London, in a horse-drawn ambulance, or even in a London taxi. Anywhere anonymous, as long as it wasn't in the family flat at Grosvenor Gardens opposite Buckingham Palace, which is where she would have been born had she been born to Lady Glamis in London. In 1937, when Elizabeth was newly ascended to the throne of England as consort, she had allowed her birthplace to be declared in that plaque at All Saints' Parish Church as St. Paul's Waldenberry, but time had shown her that this was a tactical error. And the reason why she made it? Because in 1937, when she unveiled the plaque, she was not yet alert to the danger that admitting her birthplace would place her in. She did not yet know that the Windsors were already disseminating the truth about her birth to all and sundry. Thereafter, she was assiduous in asserting that she had been born anywhere but at St. Paul's Waldenberry. Nor was she alone in doing so. She enlisted the support of the one person whom she could trust above all others, the other Benjamin, her indisputable full brother, by then the Honourable Sir David Bowes Lyon. According to the author Hugo Vickers in his 2005 biography, Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, David Bowes Lyon told the author Dorothy Laird, whose 1966 biography was written with the cooperation of Elizabeth, that she had not been born at St. Paul's. There is no doubt that this assertion cannot have been made without the connivance of Elizabeth. This placed the author in something of a quandary, for until then St. Paul's Walden had been the official birthplace. Published David Bowes Lyon's disclaimer and open up both author and subject to the prospect of cataclysmic controversy, or remain silent and continue to enjoy the cooperation of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth the Queen Mother. So Laird chose a path unique in the annals of biography and wrote a book that omits to mention any place of birth whatsoever. Thereafter, until her death, Elizabeth sowed confusion the way a biblical farmer scattered seeds, and she was able to live out the remainder of her life with her secret safe from the knowledge of the general public. An Enchanted Childhood, Chapter 2. Irrespective of who produced her, Elizabeth Bowes Lyon's birth was registered by her father Claude at the register office in Hitchin, where he paid a fine of 7 and 6, 7 shillings and 6 pence, for his tardiness on Friday, the 21st of September, 1900. Her mother was listed as Lady Glamis, and hereafter Cecilia will be referred to as her mother. The arrival of a ninth child, even a much longed-for one, is never quite as momentous as the arrival of the first, second, or third, but even so, Elizabeth's christening was almost as noteworthy as her birth because of the bizarre features surrounding it. The first issue was the godparents. All Christians understand the importance of godparents, and no one more so than an aristocrat, who chooses his or her child's godparents with a view to what help or use they will be to the child in future. Devout Christians like Claude and Cecilia also understand that the role of godparent consists of a spiritual element. They are meant to look out for the spiritual as well as the earthly well-being of their godchildren. The result is that even the most casual Christians invariably manage to provide the requisite number of godparents for their offspring, choosing the cream of the crop from amongst their friends, relations, and social connections. Elizabeth, however, might well have had no godparents, which would be truly extraordinary. Normally, the church registers the identity of the godparents and provides the parents with a baptismal certificate listing the names of the child, the officiating clergyman or clergymen, the parents, and the godparents. But this was not done, either because there were no godparents or because the Reverend Tristram Valentine was lax beyond all belief, which seems unlikely. Later on, once Elizabeth was a royal duchess and questions were raised as to who her godparents were, the family managed to remember two godmothers, though they never did summon up even one godfather, no matter how obscure or insignificant. This was also extraordinary, for all children of practicing Christians had at least one godfather if they were a girl and one godmother if they were a boy, as well as two or more godparents of the same sex. And amongst the aristocracy, 4, 5, or even 6 godparents of both sexes was the norm rather than the exception, as indeed my own children can attest to. Yet the best the Strathmore family could come up with was the sum total of 2 godmothers, both of whom were safely members of the family, Claude's spinster sister, Lady Maud Bowes Lyon, and Cecilia's decidedly rackety but nevertheless royally connected second cousin, Mrs. Arthur James. If these ladies were contemporaneous choices in September 1900, 2 more unpromising godmothers could hardly have been found for an infant who would presumably need as much assistance as any other well-born girl required as she grew into adulthood. A retiring spinster aunt would hardly be in a position to endow the infant with worldly goods or useful direction as she grew up, nor would a scandal-ridden, albeit broad-minded, miser, although both fitted the bill nicely if they stepped into the breach anachronistically. Whether Venetia James accepted becoming a godmother in 1900, when she was a still beautiful 16-inch-waisted 39-year-old who had once captivated the then Prince of Wales, or whether she did so later, one thing is certain. She was the ideal nominee for godmother if there were difficulties attached to the birth, for she had survived ostracism from the royal circle and would therefore be attuned to the nuances necessary for Elizabeth to be navigated safely through society. As a young woman, Venetia had been a luminous presence in the Marlborough House set, as the Prince and Princess of Wales's social circle was known. A great friend of his acknowledged mistress, Alice Keppel, despite having enjoyed His Royal Highness's attentions herself, she then committed the cardinal error of embarrassing Bertie and Alexandra by popping out of a huge Easter egg with whoops of delight and a decorous curtsy in front of a host of other people. This was a solecism which neither the heir to the throne nor his wife could tolerate, for they lived by the inflexible rule that no matter what you did in private, in public you preserved decorum. And such public over-familiarity, though intended good-naturedly, was a decided breach of protocol, which, if allowed to pass unpunished, might well open the floodgates to public acknowledgement of Bertie's promiscuous private life, and the attendant humiliations it heaped upon his beautiful but deaf wife. After this solecism, Venetia was therefore banished from the royal circle, and ended up a stern, miserly, severe old woman, whom people took care to avoid as much as possible. Another bizarre element of the christening was the Reverend Tristram Valentine's conduct when it came time to name Elizabeth. Rather than baptize the infant with the mixture of seriousness and joyousness which are supposed to be features of all Christian baptisms, this deeply traditional clergyman failed to name the child in keeping with his instructions. Whether he misheard, misunderstood, or deliberately resisted the choice of names he was given for this latest scion of the Bowes Lyon family, he made such a hash of the naming, both during the ceremony and afterwards when he filled out the baptismal certificate incorrectly, that it can only have been the insistence of the parents that caused him to scratch about on the certificate to rectify matters and provide her with their chosen names, Elizabeth, Angela, Marguerite. The choice of names might well have added to the problem. While Elizabeth was uncontroversial and Angela, though unaristocratic, was touching, she was her parents' angel. The inclusion of the name Marguerite might well have caused the clergyman to resort to covert resistance. For Elizabeth had also been named after the cook at St. Paul's Waldenbury, whom the local vicar will have known, and that was more than unusual. It was unthinkable. To a late Victorian clergyman, functioning in a world where there was a vast chasm between the upper and lower classes, it was literally unheard of for an aristocratic infant to be called after a servant, and while that reverberates positively with us in the 21st century, especially if Lord and Lady Glamis were being decent enough to acknowledge, albeit subtly, the part Marguerite Rodier had played in their daughter's existence, such conduct would not have been favourably received by a clergyman, especially one who, like Mr. Valentine, was a leading light in a small community and would undoubtedly have already heard the gossip, which was even then flourishing, about the strange circumstances of Elizabeth's birth. It is likely that he would have resented being implicated in an arrangement he did not particularly approve of. Nevertheless, he would have felt powerless to oppose the lord of the manor openly, for clergymen were even more dependent then than they are now upon the benevolence of the owners of the local big house. As such, Lord Glamis was not someone whom Mr. Valentine could afford to fall out with openly. On the other hand, he would also have been reluctant to sully his reputation with his flock, which he definitely would have done had he been perceived to be colluding too willingly with passing the infant off as legitimate, when local gossip already had her labelled illegitimate. So he took the only course open to him. He botched the job, just enough for his congregation to know that he had not been a willing participant, but not so much that the lord of the manor did not get what he wanted, which he did. for neither Claude nor Cecilia left All Saints until their youngest daughter had been given her full allotment of names. Fortunately for baby Elizabeth, once this hurdle had been overcome, life settled down to the agreeable tenor it would thereafter have for her. She was, indeed, a much longed-for baby, and in many ways she cannot have been born into a better family. Claude, Cecilia, and their eight other children were exceptional in many ways, not because they were one of the richest or grandest or best-connected families in the land. They were solidly of middling rank and importance amongst the aristocracy, but because they were unusually happy. This was in large measure due to Cecilia's personality, though Claude's sensible down-to-earth values contributed to this state of being. Although desirous of his children's welfare and keen that they make good matches, he was also remarkably unambitious for their advancement at court. Having been attached briefly to the palace in his youth, he had seen enough of the jockeying for position and the prostitution of values to hold the view thereafter that the one thing he did not wish for any of his children was a position at court. In a day and age when few aristocratic marriages were genuinely happy, Claude and Cecilia's was an oasis of fulfilment which highlighted the desert their peers were often forced to endure. They seemed to have been the ideal foil for each other. Both of them enjoyed social life and were constantly giving or attending parties. Like all earls of Strathmore and lords Glamis, he was quiet, somewhat taciturn, and reserved, while she was outgoing, amusing, and fun-loving. Both of them were kind-hearted, though she was the more charismatic personality of the two. Where she glittered as a personality, he was quietly but good-naturedly solid. The 27th Earl of Crawford and Balcarres described him in a diary entry for the 2nd of October 1905 as a delightful man, a sentiment everyone who crossed paths with him seemed to share, including his estate workers and tenants. Keenly interested in his estates, he rode out each day on his pony in an old mackintosh tied with twine at the waist to inspect the multitude of small holdings which he owned. Benevolence, as a landlord, was something of a tradition in the Strathmore family. In 1865, the tenants of Glamis had presented Claude's father with a silver ship in appreciation of his liberal conduct as a landlord. And when Claude wasn't checking to see that his tenants were happy, he was making innovations like importing larch from Norway to renew his forests. Something of a character, he liked to bowl food down the length of the dining table to his wife, who apparently was a dab hand at fielding whatever came flying, and enjoyed regaling his friends with how an outraged minister of the Kirk was scandalized that he would let a hired hand clear a storm drain on the Sabbath. The labourer, of course, was the Earl himself. Still, he politely wrote back, promising such a despicable act would never happen again. Whenever he suffered from insomnia, rather than while away the hours reading or resting, he would chop logs he kept at the end of his bed for that purpose. He was convinced that eggs were dangerous and was constantly warning anyone who would listen, "Poison, my dear, poison." A man of fixed habits, he would make his own cocoa every morning in a stab at self-sufficiency that was remarkable at a time when most aristocrats did not even know how to dress themselves. Liking plum pudding and failing to see why he should limit himself to it during the Christmas season only, the way everyone else did, he had it at luncheon every day of his life. In yet another stab at independence, his place at table was always set with its own jug of water, which he himself used to dilute his wine. This practice was not only admirable for what it implied about Claude's character, but says a lot about his prescience, for alcoholism ran in his family, and this was a way of controlling his intake. An avid cricketer, he used to enjoy nothing better than playing with his sons, his butler, and his valet when he wasn't blasting the grouse, partridge, pheasant, woodcock, and mallard during their respective seasons from August to February. Nowadays, people might classify Claude as having been eccentric, but at the time, when individuality was more prevalent than it is nowadays, he was perceived merely as robustly individual. Like her husband, Cecilia was both physically active and robustly individualistic. If her conduct would now be regarded as less eccentric than his, in that she had no defining peculiarities like eating Christmas pudding all year round, she was nevertheless very much her own person. William Shawcross states that she dominated her family and household, and one need look no further than Cecilia to see who became the role model for the dominating but loving Elizabeth when the time came to be matriarch of her own family. One daughter described Cecilia as a very wonderful woman, very talented, very go-ahead, and so upright. She had a terrific sympathy. The young used to pour their troubles out to her and ask for advice, often when they would not go to their own parents. She was the pivot of the family, as Elizabeth confirmed to the Archbishop of Canterbury following her death in 1938. Devoid of snobbery, she had real joie de vivre and was always finding new things to be enthusiastic about, such as creating the Italian garden at Glamis between 1907 and 1911. As this involved the felling of some 4 acres of trees and the levelling and draining of the ground, it was not a simple task, but she set the men of the estate to work on it, and to this day it stands as a testament to the artistic side of her nature. Aside from gardening, Cecilia also gave full vent to these sensibilities by creating and executing elaborate embroidery and crewel work, often while conversing in the evening after dinner. Possibly where she excelled above all else was as a storyteller. With her vivacity and imagination, qualities which Elizabeth absorbed in full, she used to entertain the children with stories about what life at Glamis had been like in centuries past. In doing so, she managed to impart to them a love of history and tradition in an entertaining, socializing way. Cecilia did not believe that her children's enjoyment should be spoilt by too much learning, and since it was she who set the tone of family life, the children's lives were turned over to pleasures, albeit innocent ones. This idyll Elizabeth tried to recreate for her own 2 daughters when their turn came to be educated, but the attempt backfired spectacularly, especially where Princess Margaret was concerned. She never forgave her mother for preventing her from having the education, her intelligence, and rank required. In other respects, however, Margaret replicated features of her mother's upbringing that owed everything to Cecilia and her strong belief that life should be as easy and pleasurable as possible. Cecilia was a practiced pianist with a good singing voice, and one of her favourite activities was to gather her large brood and many guests around the piano after dinner. Sometimes they would have sing-alongs, a practice which Elizabeth and Margaret would perpetuate into the following 2 generations, even after the advent of television made self-generated entertainment effectively redundant. On other occasions, Cecilia would provide background music on the piano while her children and their guests played charades. Cecilia seems to have been more intelligent as well as more sophisticated than Claude. This was in part due to her mother, Caroline Burnaby, who was widowed when Cecilia was only 3. 5 years later, in 1870, she married Harry Scott of Ancrum. They lived in some style at Forbes House in Ham, near London, until his death in 1889. After this, she spent most of her time in Italy, firstly at the Villa Caponi in Florence, thereafter at San Remo and Bordighera on the Italian Riviera. At a time when few people travelled extensively, Cecilia had to do so, if only to see her mother, and travel proved to be as broadening an experience as the maxim states it is. Sophisticated as she was, Cecilia and her children nevertheless were as ignorant as her husband when it came to some of the most basic matters in their lives. The year after they became the Earl and Countess of Strathmore, following his father's death in 1904, Lord Crawford had cause to say, "I am amazed at the phenomenal ignorance of the castle and its contents displayed by Lord and Lady Strathmore and the two eldest sons." The second son asked his mother about the identity of a portrait which turned out to be a portrait of his own grandmother. Although Cecilia was described as fey in manner, she was anything but fuzzy where her values or beliefs were concerned. Like many another God-fearing vicar's daughter in post-Victorian Britain, Cecilia inculcated into her family a love of God, king, and country. This was no alien concept which they could put on and take off the way they did their overcoats, but was a living, breathing part of their everyday life. It was integral to what made British best, and both Claude and Cecilia genuinely lived by the Victorian ideal of the British Empire being a force for good, which was elevating the rest of the world with a civilizing example of how British values could improve other cultures through the dissemination of Christianity, English justice, and British technological advances. Although people today might mock such values, they were fundamental to many people at that time and would prove to have a lasting impression upon Elizabeth, as did the centrality of Christian faith to Cecilia's life. She taught her children to kneel beside their beds and say their prayers every night, a practice which Elizabeth is meant to have maintained through her nearly 102 years. She made sure that the family said daily prayers together in the chapel at Glamis or at St. Paul's Waldenbury, and of course they went to church every Sunday, another of Cecilia's practices to which Elizabeth adhered all her life. Like many of her generation, Cecilia was a strong believer in duty. She set about instilling this concept in her children with the repetition of such maxims as, "Work is the rent you pay for life," and "Life is for living and working at. If anything or anyone bores you, then the fault is in yourself." These would stand her in good stead with the adult Elizabeth, but for the moment she limited herself to those maxims, as well as the one which would ensure that her youngest daughter would have good posture. "Never look at your feet." Cecilia was also a firm believer in the value of good manners, and she made sure that each of her children had the most exquisite manners. I have often said over the years that the people who have the best manners of anyone I have met are well-bred Arabs and the Japanese, with the exception of the Bowes Lyon family, who are on a par with them. The present Earl of Strathmore, for example, is as well-mannered and charming as his great-aunt Elizabeth used to be, so Cecilia's heritage resides in her Bowes Lyon descendants to this day. Like many strong and upstanding but loving women who are fun to be around, Cecilia demanded harmoniousness in her houses. According to Shawcross, she was strict without being harsh. Although her sons were elsewhere described as being wild, she plainly inspired such devotion in her large brood that none of her 10 children is on record as having even once opposed her or rebelled against her standards. This is possibly because her rules were few and far between, her expectations limited, the boundaries laid down, leaving so much scope for individual foibles that there was little to rebel against, except her hardly arduous concept of duty, which really involved being agreeable company and well-mannered while you enjoyed yourself. There are countless stories, all substantiated of the scamps the young Elizabeth and David were. At Glam's, they smoked on the stairs, and from a turret accessed by a 143-step spiral staircase, they poured cold water on the heads of well-dressed, unsuspecting guests, pretending it was hot oil. They also once painted the lower rungs of a ladder with white paint, unbeknown to the painter standing several rungs above. Much to their pleasure, his white footprints covered the whole of the lawn. On another occasion, Elizabeth cut up a new set of sheets which had been put on her bed. When the plainly astonished adult inquired of the naughty child what her mother would say when she found out, she replied jauntily, "Oh, Elizabeth!" which turned out to be the case. Elizabeth was even allowed to bring her Shetland pony, Bobs, into the house, and once even took it upstairs to her bedroom. Such latitude might have been destructive had the Bowes Lyon brood been expected to make their own way in the world, but since they were not, it laid the foundations for a happy, freewheeling, and delightfully entertaining family life. Elizabeth herself described her mother as being so vital and so loving and so marvellously loyal to those she loved or the things she thought right, an angel of goodness and fun. She had such a good perspective of life. Everything was given its true importance. She had a young spirit, great courage and unending sympathy whenever or wherever it was needed, and such a heavenly sense of humour. We all used to laugh together and have such fun. With personalities such as theirs, it is hardly surprising that Claude and Cecilia were a magnet, not only for their children, whom they loved devotedly and who all loved them in return, but also for their many friends. The death of Queen Victoria in January 1901 and the accession of her pleasure-seeking but politically astute son, Bertie, Prince of Wales, as King Edward VII, ushered in the Edwardian age. This was the apogee of the aristocratic way of life. To the adults in Elizabeth's world, life was effectively one long party, broken up into balls, dances, dinners, luncheons, picnics and hunting, shooting and fishing functions. No one, that is, no one in the aristocracy, worked, but that is not to say that they were idle. They had a duty to maintain a full and active social life, and those who did not do so quickly lost their desirability along with their kudos. During the London season, aristocrats, including Claude and Cecilia, might attend three or four balls a night. Those of cultural bent would attend the opera, ballet, theatre, or concerts, while those of artistic bent performed in their own houses and often publicly on stage in charity recitals for the poor. During the day they rode in Hyde Park or fenced when they weren't calling upon one another to drop off visiting cards or have tea. When the London season came to a close, they adjourned to their country estates, where they stayed with each other in large house parties. Then, more than now, country house visits revolved around two fixed points, the table and sport. Although some of the ladies might take their breakfast in their bedrooms, the gentlemen invariably congregated in the dining room for a full English breakfast. Both sexes gathered together for lunch, tea, and dinner, irrespective of which sport was on the calendar. The aristocracy was far more physically active then than its equivalent is today. Everyone rode, if not on a daily basis, then frequently, for motor cars were a recent and unreliable invention, and horses were an integral part of everyone's life. When people were not riding horses or ponies for pleasure, they would use them for transportation, either riding them or driving them in pony or horse-drawn traps. Everyone knew how to drive one of these conveyances, even children, for carriages were not used for everything, and only invalids did not customarily drive one of the small one-horse vehicles, which everyone used for travelling short distances in the country. Elizabeth had her own pony from an early age, and by her own admission loved tending to the horses. Fishing was another sport open to both sexes, and Elizabeth absorbed a love of that sport from both her parents. She also adopted their practice of going for long walks, which were, and regrettably sometimes still are, one of the downsides of staying in country houses. All gentlemen and many ladies also fenced, and indeed my predecessor, Gertrude, Lady Colin Campbell, was a fencing champion. Although Elizabeth never was, she did take fencing lessons, both with her brother and without, for when he was learning how to box, she pursued the more decorous art of l'épée. People like Claude and Cecilia entertained constantly when they were not staying with friends or relations. Their houses were run on orderly and well-oiled lines, with what we would nowadays regard as a plethora of staff to keep the wheels revolving smoothly. While some of the greater houses, like Blenheim Palace or Woburn Abbey, had literally hundreds of servants, workmen and gardeners, Elizabeth's parents were not in that category. At the time of Elizabeth's birth, Claude had not yet succeeded to the earldom. His father was still very much in control of the family properties, aside from St. Paul's Waldenbury, which had been ceded over to his heir. So Elizabeth and her parents and siblings were really visitors in the many houses her grandfather owned. The two main houses the family had access to were Streatham Castle, which functioned on a skeleton staff, as no one lived there permanently, and Glam's Castle, which, being the primary residence of the Earls of Strathmore, was the most fully staffed. Even so, it was hardly luxurious, and Queen Mary's unmarried equerry, Sir Richard Molyneux, who made something of a career out of staying in as many country houses as he could, dismissed it as an average picnicky place, parlour maids and that sort of stuff. It had no creature comforts, such as central heating or electricity, and indeed would not have the latter until 1929, while there is still scant evidence of the former throughout its many rooms. Torches, candles, and roaring log fires provided not only warmth and light for this ancient castle, but also atmosphere, and the Liberal Prime Minister, H.H. Asquith's son, Raymond, was glad that he had enough imagination to fancy myself in a distant century, which was nothing but a polite way of saying that he found the whole thing pretty primitive. Although St. Paul's Waldenbury was a pretty house with beautiful gardens encompassing some 60 acres of grounds and gardens, it too was hardly luxurious. It was what we would today call shabby chic, some good pieces of antique furniture with some good paintings intermingling with a quantity of attractive-looking but second-rate stuff. It also had a relatively modest number of staff. There was a 24-year-old governess named Hedwig Walters for Elizabeth's elder siblings, Marguerite Rodier, the cook, a lady's maid, a dairymaid, two footmen, a page, a housemaid, a kitchen maid, a coachman who became the chauffeur when the family got its first motor car in 1908, and a livery groom, all of whom were local, except for the French Mademoiselle Rodier. With Elizabeth's advent, the household would be swollen by two nursery additions. The nurse, as nannies were then known in aristocratic and royal circles, and the nursery maid, again both homegrown. The household was completed by Arthur Barson, the butler, who had worked his way up from footman and still functioned as Claude's valet, despite being accorded the respect due to all butlers, and therefore known by his surname alone. This was a day and age when gentlemen often called their best friends by their surnames alone, and indeed Consuelo Vanderbilt always called her ducal husband Marlborough rather than using his Christian name or nicknames. On the other hand, tradesmen were known as Mr., so the exclusion of that prefix was a compliment rather than a put-down. Glam's was also staffed primarily by locals. Elizabeth would subsequently tell Eton headmaster, Eric Anderson, during their conversations between 1994 and 1995, that her ancestral home was really like a little village. This was actually typical of the time, for most of the employees in large houses were drawn from the local villages and farms. Being the family's main establishment, Glam's had more indoor and outdoor staff than the family's other houses, but even so, no one ever recalled the castle as being as sumptuously staffed as any of the great houses of the period, where liveried footmen standing behind chairs during dinner was one of the yardsticks used to measure whether a house was grand or merely typical. Ironically, the very lack of luxuriousness was what helped to make all the Bowes Lyon family's houses so appealing to house guests. There was none of the feeling that one was in a museum and had to be careful not to break anything, the way one felt at Luton Hoo or Wentworth Woodhouse. Life at St. Paul's Waldenbury and Glam's, once Claude succeeded his father in 1904, was very, very relaxed. Indeed, ribald. House guest Prince Paul of Serbia, subsequently the regent of Yugoslavia, recounts in his memoirs what fun it was to stay at Glam's before Elizabeth married Bertie and became the Duchess of York. It is no exaggeration to say that one of the main things that attracted Bertie to Elizabeth was the great sense of fun she and her family possessed. After the constriction imposed upon him by his repressive father, King George V, and straight-laced mother, Queen Mary, this was more than a breath of fresh air. It was oxygen to someone who had been living with toxicity his whole life. Nor is it possible to exaggerate how important social life was to the aristocracy. From the days of the Stuarts, when the aristocratic way of life as we know it got underway with a real swing, until the 1990s, social life was of overriding importance to upper-class Britons. This was because socialising was not only about pleasure, though it was centred around pleasurable activities. It was primarily about confirming one's worth through the affirmation of one's stature and enhancing one's status through one's connections and social activities. In other words, it was serious work posing as pleasure. It has only been in the last two decades that there has been a diminution in the importance of aristocratic social life. As more and more members of the upper classes have joined the workforce and wealth and celebrity have eclipsed society in terms of national and international superstardom, the aristocracy, as an entity, has lost much of its cachet and no longer enjoys the prestige or influence it once did. This lessening of the aristocracy's importance and the elevation of non-aristocrats to parity and sometimes superiority has created a new social order, and this, more than anything else, has resulted in the aristocracy widening its horizons. Nowadays, everybody appreciates the value of networking, and no one feels the need to dress it up as anything else. We live in an age where ambition and advancement are desirable goals in themselves, and materialism is accepted as a more valid yardstick for association than shared backgrounds. It is fair to say that in this more egalitarian age, class has lost much of its clout. Everyone is perceived to be entitled to a stake in the game of advancement, and succeeding in it is far more important than your antecedents. Indeed, Sir Donald Gosling has far more credit socially than most marquises, and few are the ambitious Becky Sharps who would miscalculate how much more desirable one Stavros Niarchos is than a brace of Manchester Dukes and Alexander Earls. A century ago, however, British life could not have been more different. Social acceptability did not automatically or immediately follow accomplishment. It usually came humiliatingly slowly. For instance, Sir Ernest Castle, despite being enormously rich and a knight who helped to bankroll King Edward VII before and after he acceded to the throne, was never regarded as being socially acceptable, much less desirable, though his daughter would marry Lord Mountcastle and his granddaughter Edwina would underscore the family's arrival when she wed the king's cousin, Lord Louis Mountbatten. Although the most important element for inclusion in society was entitlement by right of background, once you belonged, gradations of wealth and status were leavened only by the presence of outstanding physical beauty or supreme social skills. If you had good looks or were excellent company, or better still, possessed a combination of the two, you would assuredly find yourself in the greatest demand. This is how Cecilia and her daughter Elizabeth became the successes that they did. Although neither woman was a great beauty, both of them were relatively pretty while young, and this, allied to their truly outstanding personalities, combined to attract a multitude of admirers. Both of them actually married up, and both had the charm and grace to accomplish the transition so successfully that their humbler origins were ignored. Despite this, the Strathmores were of middling aristocratic rank, and even after Claude succeeded to the earldom and the family's elevation began in earnest, Cecilia was still not one of the leading hostesses of the day. They were not rich or grand enough to belong to the haut monde, like the Marchioness of Londonderry or the Duchess of Devonshire, and no amount of social skill displayed by Cecilia could mask that fact. Nevertheless, while Elizabeth was growing up, her mother had a well-deserved reputation as a good guest and superb hostess. When she was staying with others, her sparkling good humour was an asset, and when she was the hostess, this vibrant sense of fun was heightened by the warmth of her hospitality and the relaxed tone she set for everyone. Raymond Asquith and Lord Gage were only two of the many people, aside from Prince Paul of Serbia, who commented on what a superb hostess she was, and long before her daughter Elizabeth married into the royal family, important people in society like Prince Paul and Queen Mary's lady-in-waiting, and Glam's neighbour, Mabel, Countess of Airlie, were observing that her daughter Elizabeth was as appealing a personality and enjoyable a companion as her mother. In a world where dullness was often allied to inertia, this was high praise indeed. What was Cecilia and Elizabeth's secret? It seems to have been a genuine love of social life. Both mother and daughter would entertain throughout their long lives with relish, and both would provide for their guests with such gusto that an invitation to their table or house was always welcome. While Elizabeth was growing up, staying with her parents was even more fun than staying with her would prove to be once she got married. Her royal status engulfed her in an invisible aura of unapproachability beyond which few strayed, and it would take time for her to come to terms with this once she got married. Until she did, she would question whether people liked her for herself or her royal status. Being royal, she discovered, like many another royal bride coming after her, was not all it was cooked up to be, but she persevered, and with time found the way to enjoy being royal without sacrificing her innate personality, the way Queen Mary did. As Elizabeth would replicate the atmosphere of her earlier life once she became royal, it is useful to explore what this early life really was like. Cecilia, as a hostess, had a sure touch born out of genuine commitment to fun and good manners, intermingled with a true love of people. At her house parties, she ensured that there was lively conversation in a relaxed, convivial way by surrounding herself with the children she had trained to be entertaining, as well as by including as many of her scintillating friends to act as a counterweight to the dullards whom one had to endure. Conversational boundaries at St. Paul's Waldenbury, Glam's and Streatham were delightfully lacking in delineation except where offensiveness or vulgarity was concerned. Appreciating that conversation was only one part of the fun to be had, Cecilia and her brood organised entertaining, sometimes silly, games such as charades, blind man's buff, and Are You There, Moriarty? Her descendants would perpetuate these long after she had died. The family would explore dungeons with their guests and sometimes thrill and sometimes frighten them with ghost stories about Glam's. The castle was reputedly haunted, so this was a rich vein to explore, as were the many stories surrounding its bloodthirsty past. Although Shakespeare placed Duncan's demise there, it is more likely that it was Duncan's grandfather who died there. Irrespective of whose blood marked this hall or that floor, it was all a real link to the ages past, and few visitors failed to leave unmoved by the castle and its occupants. Occasionally, the family would host balls, usually at Glam's, and these were also thoroughly enjoyable, the wildness of the Scottish setting adding atmosphere to the occasion, as Raymond Asquith recounted in his 1905 diary entry. The place is an enormous 10th-century dungeon. It was full of torches and wild men in kilts and pretty women pattering on the stone stairs with satin slippers. Elizabeth's parents were sufficiently well connected and moneyed to live comfortable lives surrounded by their peers, but not being one of the preeminent aristocratic families in the land and with no ambitions to join such hallowed ranks, they were free to behave as they saw fit. While such eminences as the Dukes of Argyll and Marlborough and others of their ilk had such constraints upon their conduct that personal and marital happiness were usually throttled at the umbilicus, Claude and Cecilia could, and did, dedicate themselves to rich and fulfilling lives within the bosom of their large family and amongst their many friends. Elizabeth and David profited from this even more than their older siblings, who had been raised before Claude succeeded to the earldom, for they were no longer guests in the family's houses, but hosts themselves. If life in Claude and Cecilia's family was more enjoyable than life within many of their peers' families, this was not the only feature that set the Strathmores apart. The family was unusually, indeed, anachronistically, child-centred. There was none of the children are to be seen and not heard dicta, which were then characteristic of most well-bred households. Whenever Elizabeth and David were taught a new dance by their dance master, Mr. Neil of Forfar, they were encouraged to show it off to the assembled adults, though they had to maintain decorum and remain in character until they had been applauded. If they had an opinion, they were encouraged to deliver it, no matter how young they were, the only proviso being that they should do so politely and civilly. This combination of discipline and indulgence clearly brought out the best in Elizabeth, though whether it did not undermine the children's characters is open to question. It was often commented upon by Elizabeth herself, as well as by David and everyone who knew them well, how very similar in character they were. While Majesty protected her reputation in later life, he did not have a similar shield. During the Second World War, when he was sent to New York to take over the political warfare and propaganda work of British security coordination, he not only fomented untold mischief for the Duke and Duchess of Windsor on behalf of his sister, but proved to be such a disaster at the job. "David has a poor mind and no knowledge of Europe," wrote Sir Robert Bruce Lockhart, Director General of the Political Warfare Executive, and as such, David's actual boss. that Minister of Information Brendan Bracken, who was Churchill's protégé, dismissed him as an intriguer and wanted to be rid of him. But he enjoyed the protection of his sister, the Queen, and Lord Halifax, the British ambassador in Washington, who was her good friend, so he remained en poste as his infamy spread. Bruce Lockhart even went to the lengths of recording in his diaries that he is quite incapable of playing straight, while John Wheeler Bennett, King George VI's official biographer, regarded him as a bad man and had a low opinion of David's character and thinks that his capacity for intrigue and untruthfulness has no limit. Because Elizabeth and David were acknowledged to be so similar, when all these individuals came to publish their works, they would do so in the knowledge that the conoscenti would read the word David and include Elizabeth as well. When they were youngsters, however, their characters had still not been formed. The three most important adult presences in their young lives were their parents and their nurse, Ella, whom Cecilia employed for Buffy, as Elizabeth was known in the family when she was a month old. Born Clara Cooper Knight, Ella was the daughter of a tenant farmer on Claude's Hertfordshire estate. She stayed with the family throughout her working life, leaving the Strathmore household when Elizabeth was 11 to care for the children of the eldest living daughter, May, by then Lady Elphinstone. She returned to Elizabeth's household in 1926 when she gave birth to the present Queen. Thereafter, Ella nursed both Lilibet and Margaret when she came along 4 years later. When the former married Prince Philip and produced Prince Charles in 1948, she joined the Edinburghs at Clarence House to take care of their infant son. The way the adult Elizabeth spoke about the devoted Ella says much about both of them. Although Elizabeth remained fond of her nurse all her life, she always had a cool, detached eye and was never one to miss the quip which summed up the person while ensuring that her audience had a good laugh. On the 19th of June, 1932, she informed Viscountess Astor that their holiday at Rest Harrow in Sandwich was the first time she had ever known Ella to display enthusiasm for anything. Whether Ella was as dour as Elizabeth remembered is a moot point. None of her other charges seem to have found her so, and there is every reason to suppose that the unfortunate nurse simply had the task of restraining an ebullient child who was precocious and self-willed, and who would grow into an equally ebullient and strong-willed woman. Not for nothing was Elizabeth known within the family as Merry Mischief and the Imp. Yet there was clearly affection on both sides. Ella remembered her first charge as being an exceptionally happy, easy baby, crawling early, running at 13 months, and speaking very young. Although one always has to guard against exaggeration when people, especially employees, speak about the great and the good, royalty above all, her comments have the ring of truth. All the evidence points to the fact that Elizabeth was always bright, with a sunny disposition and a captivating personality. Even her enemies in later life would always concede that she was intelligent, appeared to be easy to get along with, and was extraordinarily charming. This really was a case of the baby, then the little girl, foreshadowing the qualities the woman would possess. Nor was the young Elizabeth's personality the only appealing thing about her. Although in adulthood she would run to fat and become dumpy, and in so doing lose whatever look she might once have had, she was nevertheless an unusually pretty baby and little girl. All the photographs and portraits show a beautiful, angelic-looking child with huge blue eyes, a delicate nose, cute mouth, long, dark hair, and a truly beautiful complexion which she would never lose. As the family's letters make clear, Elizabeth was adored by both her parents, and in turn she adored them. her mother even more so than her father. In adulthood, she would express doubt as to whether she would survive her mother's ultimate demise, which shows the extent to which she was emotionally wrapped up with her. Cocooned in this chrysalis of loving approval, delineated only by the need to avoid offensiveness and overt aggression, Elizabeth grew into a delightful little girl whose precocity was endearing rather than off-putting. Once, when she was 3 years old, her mother came down to see her daughter holding forth as she poured tea for neighbours who had arrived early. Not only was she behaving more the way an adult would than a child of such tender age, but she had even ordered the tea herself. Her grandmother, Caroline Scott, also gives us a glimpse of what Elizabeth was like at that age. She was quite a companion, and was already displaying signs of what Princess Margaret would acidly refer to as Mummy's irresistible persuasiveness, although Mrs. Scott found her coaxy little ways delightful and relished her company. This bright little girl was already observant beyond her years. Once she went into the kitchen and informed the staff, "If you could make the pats of butter smaller, it would be much better. Persons leave some of the big pats on their plates, and that is very waste." One can readily imagine how amused the recipient of her order might have been, although since this anecdote was deployed to illustrate how she would boss the kitchen staff, it is possible that there were already people who found her extreme self-assertiveness off-putting rather than enchanting. "We followed the birds," Queen Elizabeth used to say of her parents' schedule, and this pithy comment was undeniably true. Out of the shooting season, St. Paul's Waldenbury was the family's main base. Between 1906 and 1920, they also had 20 St. James's Square, a large Adam house between the Board of Trade and the Cleveland Club off Pall Mall, which Claude leased. Their neighbours included some of England's greatest aristocrats, including the Duke of Norfolk, the Duchess of Buckingham, and the Earl of Derby. This was certainly a vast improvement on Belgrave Mansions, the apartment near to Victoria Station on Grosvenor Gardens behind Buckingham Palace, which had been their London residence prior to Claude's accession to the earldom. When the London season was over, they would sometimes head to Streatham Castle in County Durham, no longer as guests, but as hosts. This large and splendidly proportioned Baroque historic house, sitting in 1,190 acres, had an estate of 20 farms. There was also the magnificent Jacobean stately home, Gibside Hall, in striking distance, but the family had never lived there or even visited, as it was rented out from 1908 to a Gateshead solicitor named Victor Crunnett, and after the Great War, during which time the army girls were billeted in the servants' quarters, Claude had this architectural gem dismantled rather than undertake the expense of restoring it to its former splendour. In 1920, he had all its treasures, including fixtures and fittings, carted off to Glamis. It was then blown up in 1959 as a part of a military exercise, so no trace of it remains. There were two other valuable, though less impressive properties nearby, Howick and Wemmingill, but these too were not occupied by the family. To the young Elizabeth, however, only one place was home. As her younger brother David put it, both Benjamins thought of Glamis as a holiday place, Streatham as a visit, and St. Paul's as home. One can see why they felt like this. St. Paul's Waldenbury was a lovely Queen Anne house covered in honeysuckle and magnolia. Elizabeth's first biographer, Lady Cynthia Asquith, described it as having an atmosphere of a happy English home, possessing so many of the familiar delights of childhood, charades, schoolroom tea, homemade toffee, Christmas Eve, hide-and-seek. Nowhere in this well-worn house, one feels, can there ever have been strict rules as to the shutting of doors, the wiping of boots, or the putting away of toys. There was none of the Victorian and Edwardian edict that children must be seen, not heard. Both Elizabeth and the closest companion of her childhood, her younger brother David, enjoyed the many benefits that beloved children of means do. While Glam's was fun, in a gory sort of way, when the Scottish mists parted and the Scottish rain declined to sog the summer's ground, it was St. Paul's Waldenbury, which they truly loved. There were barns to explore, fields to tramp through, outbuildings which made for mysterious and wonderfully messy adventure. From an early age, Elizabeth loved horses and enjoyed polishing the bits which the stable boys gave her. Absolute bliss was how she described this pastime. She delighted in playing in the gardens which were her mother's pride and joy. Designed originally by Geoffrey Jellicoe in the 18th century, then supplemented over the centuries by others, including Cecilia, there were vistas ending in statues and a woodland beyond it where beech hedges delineated long grassy avenues which were intersected by lateral rides. There were ponds to wade in and a vast oak tree which Elizabeth used to climb or use as a hiding place. There was a rock garden, but above all, at the bottom of the garden, where the sun always seems to be shining, is the wood, the haunt of fairies with its anemones and ponds and moss-grown statues, and the big oak. At this stage of their lives, the two Benjamins functioned as a unit. "We were never separated if we could avoid it," David said. They devised a hiding place in an old brew house where they stashed their haul of forbidden delicacies acquired by devious devices. This store consisted of apples, oranges, sugar, sweets, slabs of chocolat meunier, matches and packets of woodbines, cigarettes. The only way to gain access to this hiding place was a very rotten ladder which no adult could ascend. This was ideal for escaping morning lessons, which they often did, without ever once being punished for doing so. Mrs. Thompson, the housekeeper, remembered Elizabeth and David as being the dearest little couple, and confirmed that Elizabeth always took the lead. She would come tripping down the stairs, and it would be, "Mrs. Thompson, have you any of those nice creams left for us?" And she would herself open the cupboard and help herself to what she liked best. Notwithstanding Cecilia's belief that civility came before academia, she was careful that all her children had the knowledge which they would need to see them through the aristocratic way of life. Cecilia herself taught Elizabeth and David the rudiments of writing, dancing, drawing, and music. Elizabeth's first piano lesson being the musical pathway, and as soon as they were old enough, she organized dancing, fencing, and piano lessons for them. A well-bred person who could not dance well was regarded as a social liability, so it was important that Elizabeth, even more than David, should excel. Aristocratic girls needed every edge they could get in the marital rat race, which began as they approached 18, and the younger they started dancing lessons, the better dancers they would become. Aside from Mr. Neil in Forfa, who taught Elizabeth and David when they were at nearby Glam's Castle, there was Madame d'Aigueville in London. Fortunately for her parents, Elizabeth showed an early aptitude for dancing. Later on, she enjoyed a reputation amongst her peers as a superb dancer, and there are many photographs of the ancient Elizabeth reeling the night away as she approached 100 years old. As neither Elizabeth nor David would need to defend themselves socially with the sword, fencing was not regarded as anything but a minor, though aristocratic, accomplishment. But piano playing was altogether different. Once more, this was a skill which was more necessary for girls to master than for boys. because married men were not necessarily required to sit down and play a piano of an evening, but married women were, and a music-loving beau might just opt for the better pianist amongst the many girls who would form the marriage market they would all need to compete in. It was therefore perceived as essential that young ladies who were not inordinately rich in their own right played the piano well. Cecilia provided not only an example, but also encouragement, which, once more, was not lost on the young Elizabeth, who was sent to Madame Mathilde Verne's pianoforte school at 194 Cromwell Road, South Kensington. Mathilde Verne was no slouch. She was a well-regarded concert pianist who had been taught by the great Clara Wieck Schumann in Frankfurt for 4 years prior to embarking upon a successful career in England. After a brief stint as a piano teacher at the Royal College of Music, she set up her own piano school in 1909. Her star pupil, between 1910 and 1915, was the great English pianist Solomon, whom she discovered. She also discovered Dame Maura Limpany. During Elizabeth's tenure at the school, the former Miss Vorm played under Henry Wood at the Queen's Hall Promenade concerts and thereafter at the Sunday afternoon concerts. Although pupils like Elizabeth were the bread and butter which kept the school afloat, Madame Verne recognised early on that Elizabeth did not have the character to become an accomplished pianist, irrespective of how much innate talent she might have had. The young Elizabeth, unsurprisingly considering her mother's attitude to effort, was both work-shy and unwilling to extend herself if something did not come easily. Madame Verne observed an incident in which one of Elizabeth's teachers was trying to get her to persevere with exercises which were causing her some trouble. I looked at the child. Though reverent in face, there was a warning gleam in her eyes as she said to the teacher, "Thank you very much, that was wonderful," and promptly slid off the music stool, holding out her tiny hand in polite farewell. Although Elizabeth was eventually persuaded to return to her lesson, Madame Verne had gained a real insight into the determined but infinitely polite way in which she ensured that she got her own way, irrespective of who or what was involved. Even more revealing is the pride which Elizabeth took in her ability to get her own way. Time and again she would allude to it in the future, but Madame Verne's observations were written with Elizabeth's collusion in 1927, long before she had had the opportunity to establish just how determined a character she was. So she was clearly happy for others to make the point for her. No education, not even one as lacking as Elizabeth's, could entirely ignore academe. By the time Elizabeth was old enough to enter the schoolroom at St. Paul's Waldenbury, Hedwig Walters had been replaced as governess by Miss Mary Wilkie. Lessons took place mostly in the mornings, hence why she and David often hid in the flea house, where no adult could climb up the rickety, rotting steps to fetch them. Miss Wilkie agreed with Madame Verne's assessment of Elizabeth as being a very pretty, vivacious little girl, and stayed with the family for some 9 years, teaching both the Benjamins. However, she did not travel with them, for when the children were at Glam's, their governess was Miss Laurel Gray. Miss Gray provided a vignette of the bright and sparky little girl Elizabeth was when she recounted their first meeting. "I expect that you can spell quite long words," she said, assessing her new pupil. "Oh, yes, I can spell capercailzie and ptarmigan," she replied without a smidgen of bashfulness. Cecilia required the governess to keep a record of her pupils' progress. When they were good, a good mark and a penny, and of course a bad mark, that was shocking, Miss Gray recalled. Elizabeth wasn't too good, but she always had a good mark. She was naturally a good scholar. A bad mark made no difference to David. I was as strict as I could be. He was terrible. there was also a French governess in the form of Mademoiselle Lyon, known to the children by the contraction Mad, as were all their subsequent French governesses. Celia believed in holiday governesses who would speak to the children in their national language, whether it was French or German. She worked with them from about 1901 till 1910. Unlike the regular governess who did not travel with the family, Madeleine could be found with them whatever side of the border they were on. The evidence suggests that while Elizabeth and David were taught full-time by governesses when they were in Hertfordshire or Scotland, in London their parents took a stab at sending them to kindergarten when they were approaching 9 and 7 respectively. They were sent to the Froebel-trained Miss Constance Gough's school in Marylebone. Joan Ackland, a fellow pupil, was impressed by their good manners and devotion to each other, while Elizabeth remembered the plays they performed in French and German and being called a show-off for starting an essay on the sea with the Greek version of that word. But the family's peregrinations came before education, and when it suited Claude and Cecilia, the youngsters were duly yanked out of school for their governesses to resume their hodgepodge of an education. Grief, however, was about to tear a hole in the even tenor of the family's happy life, the way it had prior to Elizabeth's birth. By Easter 1911, Elizabeth's third brother, Alec, who had suffered from increasingly bad headaches ever since he was hit on the head by a cricket ball at Eton, was visibly declining. That July, his elder brother, Jock, who was working in Boston for an American bank, responded to a letter their mother had written him, alerting him to his younger brother's deteriorating health. "What do the doctors say about the condition of his head? Poor Alec, what an awful long time it has been for him." Although the doctors could not yet say with certainty that he had a brain tumour, it was obvious he did, even before he died in his sleep, early on the morning of the 19th of October, 1911. Although Cecilia had had warning of the death of this 24-year-old son, who had been tall, good-looking, and charming, she was once more overcome by grief, the way she had been when she had lost her firstborn child. Even though Cecilia would finally recover sufficiently to function, her loved ones were all painfully aware that the loss of a second child had left her in an even more fragile state than she had been after Violet's death. Thereafter, the family in general, and Elizabeth in particular, became overtly watchful of Cecilia's well-being, and there are several contemporaneous accounts of the consideration Elizabeth and the other children paid their mother. Time, however, is its own palliative. When the Titanic sank in April 1912, family life was already back on an even keel, and preparations were being made for David to go away to school. All of Elizabeth's older brothers had been sent to Eton, and at the beginning of the school year in 1912, when David was 10, he was sent as a precursor to preparatory school at St. Peter's Court in Broadstairs, Kent. Prince Henry and Prince George, two of King George V's and Queen Mary's three youngest sons, were also students there prior to going to Eton, though David seems never to have been particularly friendly with either of them. "David went to school for the first time on Friday. I miss him horribly," Elizabeth wrote in the diary she kept intermittently. Although not a boarder like him, she now started at the Mrs. Birtwistle's Academy at 30 Sloane Street off Knightsbridge in London. The Mrs. Dorothy and Irene Birtwistle were two spinsters who ran what was, for its time, a superior educational establishment. Elizabeth was taught 13 different subjects, including history, geography, geometry, arithmetic, natural history, scripture, English grammar, English composition, English literature, English recitation, French history, and French. Although she had no aptitude for arithmetic, she showed ability in English, history, and scripture, three subjects which her mother had inculcated into her through storytelling, and in the case of the scriptures, by reading a chapter in the Bible to her every afternoon during their rest. In the late 1960s, when my brother Michael was sitting his dinners at Gray's Inn, he used to room with Dorothy Birtwistle, who had long since retired from teaching and had opened up her house in Guildford, Surrey, to law students as paying guests. Miss Birtwistle was a game old bird who enjoyed reminiscing about her former students, Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, included. She remembered Elizabeth well, and used to regale my brother with accounts of the bright, sweet, mischievous, and lazy child she was. Charm she had in spades, self-possession too, but she was also a wily little devil who could and did get away with all sorts of mischief. Even at that age, she had perfected the art of hiding behind an angelic exterior. But the glint of steely determination which Madame Verne discerned was also picked up by Miss Birtwistle, who was nevertheless sad to see Elizabeth leave her academy after the Easter term of 1913. "I was not surprised with the life she ended up having," Miss Birtwistle told my brother Michael. "I could see, even when she was 12, that she would make her mark on the world if given a chance." Miss Birtwistle liked her, but she said she never trusted her. She found her too wily to be trustworthy. Elizabeth said later that she did not think she learned anything at the Birtwistles, though a little bit of poetry I certainly remember, so I'm afraid I'm uneducated on the whole. Her school reports tell another story. Whether it was the lapse of time which made her memory fade, or she was reluctant to give credit where it was due to people whom she might not have liked because they have pressurized her into working harder than she wished to, is open to interpretation. What is not, however, is the fact that she misinformed Eric Anderson about the standard of education at the Mrs. Birtwistle's Academy, where pupils were expected to apply themselves to their schoolwork rather than flirt with knowledge while smiling angelically and doing the minimum. Performing true to the dictum that pleasure came before formal education, but that civilization was of paramount importance, Cecilia removed Elizabeth from the Mrs. Birtwistle's Academy and took her, along with David, to visit her mother Caroline Scott in Bordighera. From there, they moved to the Hotel Minerva in Florence, where they visited art galleries and churches and the nearby town of Fiesole. When they returned to England, David went back to his prep school, while, if Elizabeth's diary's entries for the 2nd and 3rd of June 1913 are to be believed, she was enrolled at Miss Wolfe's classes in South Audley Street, Mayfair. This establishment had two merits. It was closer to St. James's Square, so the walk to school with her nanny was shorter for Elizabeth, and it was easier academically. What it lacked in educational accomplishment, it made up for with the quality of its students, who included the vastly rich Sir Alfred Mons' daughter Eva, later the Marchioness of Reading and mother of Elizabeth's good friend in adulthood, Lady Zuckerman, and Earl Spencer's daughters Delia and Lavinia, both of whom would become great friends of hers in later life. In London, I went to what was called classes. One terrifying person called Miss Wolfe, she asserted, providing the reason why her mother now sought out yet another temporary governess prior to removing Elizabeth from yet another educational establishment. Clearly, Elizabeth and work were anathema to each other. Käthe Kübler was the latest in this long line of temporary governesses. She later published her memoirs once Elizabeth was famous, so there is a written record of this period, including her first day at St. Paul's Waldenbury. She arrived on a wonderfully sunny spring afternoon to find the family having tea in the garden room overlooking the park. They greeted her warmly, and after they had all finished their tea, Elizabeth took her to look at the dogs and horses. Her dog Juno had recently given birth to 5 puppies, and Fraulein Kubler wrote, "As soon as she noticed that I loved animals, I knew that I had won her over." Fraulein Kubler had certainly made a hit with her charming, if troublesome, charge, and within 2 weeks Cecilia was offering her a permanent position, if she was willing to undertake all of Elizabeth's education. As this included gymnastics, drawing, piano lessons and needlework, as well as all the academic subjects, the prospect might have been a daunting one for a less strong character than this 21-year-old daughter of a Prussian official from Erlangen, Bavaria. But Fraulein Kubler was not intimidated. In her own words, "I was very willing to do so, and so we both set to work with zest. Hitherto Lady Elizabeth had had only French governesses, and she had been to school only for a very short time. A regular education, as we know it in Germany, was something quite unknown to her. With true German thoroughness, I drew up a timetable for her lessons and a plan of study, both of which were approved by Lady Strathmore." This timetable kicked off with a piano lesson before breakfast. After that meal, governess and charge would adjourn to the schoolroom, where the first lesson began at 9:30. The curriculum covered literature, mathematics, geography, history, science, French and German. Lessons which stopped at 4:30 in the afternoon were in English, though out of the schoolroom, Käthe Kubler spoke to Elizabeth only in German. After tea, they would go walking or play golf or tennis, and sometimes they would go for a picnic tea in the woods. On these occasions, they would load up the pony cart with a basket containing sandwiches and cake, and once they had chosen their spot for the picnic, they would build a fire and heat up the water for their tea. During the strawberry and gooseberry season, they would also decamp to the kitchen garden, where Lady Elizabeth was adept at crawling under the netting and filling herself with strawberries while lying on her stomach, to quote Fraulein Kubler. This rustic way of life suited Elizabeth better than the Bert Whistle's Academy or Miss Wolfe's classes. But the London season meant that her parents had to base themselves during the week at 20 St. James's Square, and there was no question of them leaving Darling Elizabeth, as they customarily referred to her, in the country. So Fraulein Kubler and Elizabeth would head up to town as well, where lessons took place at home. Afterwards, there would be walks in Hyde Park and ballet and dancing lessons interspersed with visits to the cinema to see the latest silent, moving pictures from America. Käthe Kubler's memoirs confirm how social the Strathmores were. During the day, they would frequently host luncheons, which both governess and charge attended. She proudly recounted having sat next to the former Prime Minister, the 5th Earl of Rosebery, and the former Viceroys of India, the 1st Marquess Curzon of Kedleston, and the 5th Marquess of Lansdowne. In the evening, like two characters out of a movie, Elizabeth and Käthe Kubler would watch from a vantage point on the landing upstairs as Claude and Cecilia's guests arrived for one of the evening receptions which they frequently held. No one stayed in London over the weekend, so the family would return to Hertfordshire. Here, Fraulein Kubler recalled, "On Sunday morning, we all went to the little village church together, and at 4 p.m. there was often a cricket match. Lord Strathmore and his 4 eldest sons would play with the village lads, and the butler and valet played too. Lady Rose, the elder, beautiful sister, who would later become Countess Granville, Lady Elizabeth and I sat in the field and watched."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.